craft is growing in this country and there are so many black covens, I am issuing a challenge to the others. Come out and fight me for my throne. Only then will I step down from my title. Until then, I am Witch Queen of this country and I will stay as thus. I am the only person, and my husband is the only high priest in this country that people can turn to seek answers for witchcraft. If they have had pishoks worked against them, then they come to us. So far, we're the only people that have stood up and helped them. And therefore, I claim my title.
Janet Farrer, age 27, from Clapham, East London, a former model and receptionist. Husband, Stuart Farrer, age 61, from Walthamstow, East London, a writer by trade. He served as a journalist with Reuter and Rivali, wrote scripts for British Pathé and a variety of television dramas, notably Dr. Finlay's Casebook and Emergency Ward 10, Special Branch and Crossroads, and many radio dramas. He's the author of 9 books, mainly fiction. The theme of his most recent work is witchcraft, written with his wife as collaborator. But how does one become a witch?
You become a witch by being initiated by another witch, by a high priest or high priestess. If you're a man, you're initiated by a woman. If you're a woman, you're initiated by a man. This has always been traditional, except parents and children.
And what does that do for you? What happens after that? Spiritually and physically, anything?
Very much the same as deciding to become a Christian or a Jew or a Muslim or what have you.
A childhood friend who I've known for many years became interested in the occult, and my first instinct, quite honestly, was devil worship, orgies, sex, drugs. So I went along with her, absolutely determined to save her soul. In the end, she lost interest in it, it just wasn't for her, and I stayed. I loved it so much. It was the first religion I've ever come across that to me meant something. Made me actually feel that there was something personal about a religion. I mean, to me, the Christian
Janet and Stuart met in 1970 through their mutual interest in witchcraft. They married in 1975 and founded their own coven. Last year, with Janet's father, they came, bell, book and candle, to Ireland.
Everybody, Protestant, Catholic alike, have been very, very friendly and kind to us.
Do you think that people are still nevertheless afraid of you because you were a declared witch?
Well, one or two are, but they're not round the Ferns area. I mean, there is one woman we know of who thinks we sacrifice animals and children, and nothing we said would make any difference, despite the fact that, as you've seen today, we surround ourselves with animals. And we
would it be difficult for you to initiate me?
I'd have to know a lot about you first. Whether you were sincere, one thing, whether your wife was interested. For the simple reason, it works better if you have a working group, a group of partners, people who are in tune with each other. And if I thought you were going behind your wife's back, then I would be very, very wary of initiating you, unless I knew her, and she got on with the group, and she'd met them and liked them.
As it exists at present, it is a revival movement, and modern witches are modern citizens. They live in an ordinary world, but they're trying at the same time to get back to their natural roots.
Well, when you say natural roots, do you mean also back to nature? Is there a lot of nudity involved in coven meetings?
Ritual nudity, yes. A lot of covens practice it, but this is very old and traditional. It is psychologically helpful. It helps you. You're trying to be yourself, and there's nothing so image-forming as clothes. and get rid of those, and you're halfway to
because of the
discovering what you are yourself.
Do you think that it might attract the wrong sort of person?
It does attract them, and this is the lovely thing about it, that once they come and they find that there are no sex orgies, they very quickly lose interest.
We find that if somebody is interested in witchcraft as a religion, wants to join the group, we always say to them, well, if you want to wear a robe, please do. You know, we have them for you. And usually we find that halfway through the first circle, they just feel silly, and they want to take it off and be like everyone else. And you find after one or two meetings, it just seems perfectly natural. It's our Sunday best.
What about the kind of people that come to your own coven? From what walks of life do they belong?
We have had policemen, doctors, nurses, building site labourers, housewives, television cameraman, and even once an Indian princess.
What's the significance of things like this? Knives, for example. They look, you know, quite lethal, and one usually associates knives with pain.
Ah, well, not in witchcraft, because knives are a symbol of fire. The altar is laid out in symbols of air, earth, fire and water. It's rather like in Christianity, St. Michael, the slayer of dragons, the slayer of evil and the devil. This is the true witch's weapon, the athame, the magical weapon of the witch. Each witch has his own personal athame, or black-handled knife, with which he uses the power to cast circles and to conjure the spirits that come to our circles, the angels and the good spirits. It's very much like the symbol of St. Michael. It's a fiery thing to defend the circle and defend the honour of God who created us. And as such, it is never used to draw blood. And no witch may use his athame in any other purpose except for peacefully and ritually.
If she is a natural clairvoyant, and, you know, things just come to her like that, out of the blue, and again, it's amazing how spot on they are.
In one case, I wished ill on a man, not deliberately. I told him to shut up. I put so much vehemence in it, he lost his voice for about 48 hours.